While global leaders meet to discuss action on climate change, one new threat has emerged in the world's oceans. As Scott Shafer from our San Francisco station KQED reports, the threat may not be visible to the naked eye, but it changes the very chemistry of essential parts of the marine ecosystem.
Coral reefs like these, vibrant and teeming with life, may hold clues to the future of the world's oceans.
Coral reefs only make up a fraction of 1% of the ocean, but they hold 25% of the ocean species. Not only that, but they feed hundreds of millions of people, and a billion people or more get some income from coral reefs. So this is an ecosystem that is really fundamental to humans on the planet.
Steve Palumbi is the director of Stanford University's Hopkins Marine Station. He studied coral reefs around the world. For decades, warming ocean waters have damaged, even killed, coral. But Palumbi says reefs are now facing an insidious threat from a chemical change that is making ocean water more acidic.
Ocean acidification affects the entire globe's ocean, and it affects organisms by reducing their growth rate and by making it more difficult to make shells. We know that fish actually react to dangers differently.
With ocean surface waters now 30% more acidic than they were two centuries ago, protecting the reefs from acidification is no easy task.
It's not a problem you can just turn around very quickly. It's a problem that once it gets really bad enough so that it is having an incredible global effect, there's nothing you can do about it. You have to stop it before that point.
The increase in acidity is largely the result of people burning coal, oil, and other fossil fuels. That pumps massive amounts of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, which then sinks into the ocean waters at a rate of 9 billion tons per year. The carbon dioxide robs the oceans of an essential element that corals and other animals need to thrive.
Corals make skeletons. That's the white part of a coral reef. And the skeletons are made of calcium carbonate. Calcium carbonate tends to dissolve if the acid level in water gets too high.
This model shows how the ocean chemistry has changed since 1885 and how it is expected to change over the next 80 years. The blue represents ocean conditions good for shell and coral growth. The orange represents conditions that make it difficult for many animals to grow shells or skeletons.
There's a few of them right here. Most of them might be deeper.
Jim Berry is a senior scientist at the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute. He's looking at the effects of ocean acidification on a variety of sea life, including deep-sea coral.
The ocean critters out here are faced with a faster and larger change in ocean chemistry than they've seen for 30 to maybe 300 million years through much of their evolutionary history.
Berry says if one species suffers, an entire food web can suffer.
We could just measure this motility rate. But
Berry and researcher Charles Bach are studying how ocean acidification affects abalone, specifically whether it interferes with the ability of the shellfish to reproduce. Inside a chilly lab, Bach is inducing female abalones to spawn. Each female releases streams of small green eggs through its respiratory holes. An abalone can spawn tens of thousands of eggs at a time. In one tank are the females, in another, the males.
What you're seeing is puffs of cloud, white streams that are the sperm being released.
Bach and Berry are putting the eggs and sperm together in water with varying levels of acidity to examine how it affects fertilization.
Maybe what we saw in the last experiment where fertilization was lower in low pH, maybe it's because the sperm aren't swimming as fast.
Their research suggests that ocean acidification significantly reduces the abalone's fertilization rate. Abalone are an important source of food for sea otters, who in turn help keep kelp forests in balance.
We know that ocean acidification is huge. This is one of the biggest things that happened to this earth in the last many tens of millions of years. It's a huge environmental change that's happening right in front of us.
Terry Sawyer runs Hog Island, an oyster farm on Tomales Bay, 30 miles north of San Francisco.
And this is a big Pacific oyster. This is how big they will get.
Sawyer says ocean acidification is already affecting his business.
It's really scary. It's a very scary place to be.
The wake-up call for him came in 2005. That's when there were massive die-offs at oyster hatcheries along the Oregon and Washington coasts. Those hatcheries supplied Sawyer and many other shellfish farmers with the seeds and larvae they needed to grow their oysters.
The larvae was completely dying, and their seed was completely dying. It's not a way to run a business.
Sawyer says he's concerned not only for his business, but for all the animals who live in or depend on the oceans.
Feels like we're in the position being the canary in the coal mine. The thing is I'm holding the canary. And so I've got a responsibility to say, well, all right, we have symptoms here that, you know, that animal just died. Okay, what are we gonna do now?
Sawyer and researchers from the University of California, Davis, are now monitoring the water quality in real time.
The purple line is pH.
The data helps Sawyer and other oyster farmers in the area adjust planting schedules. To prepare for changing conditions, Hog Island is building its own hatchery. A large oyster hatchery has already moved to Hawaii, leaving the more caustic waters of the Pacific Northwest.
That's great for that hatchery, but what does it mean for all the animals that are already living there? They can't move.
Jim Berry fears it may already be too late to save coral reefs. He points out that four of the last five big extinctions on Earth included ocean acidification. Scientists say it is unclear if ocean acidification has reached a tipping point.
Some people think we might be 80 years from being there. Now is probably the last generation where we can actually change the trajectory.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Scott Shafer in Monterey, California.
Later tonight on PBS, a look at the recovery of Monterey Bay, California, in a BBC co-production over the next three nights. Big Blue Live will tell the story of whales, sea otters, and other marine animals who've returned to the bay after they almost disappeared decades ago.